And we are live. Welcome to the second episode, the first proper episode, episode one of the Geek Book Club, your online book club for geeks, by geeks, joined as always by my co-host, Andrew, who got a much better view of the almost apocalypse world-ending eclipse than I did in Southern California. You said, like, even the cicadas started chirping today.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we were just very silently waiting for the purge to begin as the totality hit. So, yeah, it was spectacular. Absolutely, we actually saw Venus, so it was pretty
rad. No, that's great, because I mean, like, here, Southern California, we're known for our, you know, wide open skies, you know, clear blue skies, it's summer weather, everything's great. And this whole week has been like, well, kind of overcast, a little drizzly in the mornings. And so I'm going out there and it's getting dimmer, but there's so much cloud cover we couldn't see anything. It's like our southwestern paradise just totally failed us on like the most important day in 30 years.
Yeah, well, you know, it was in certain parts of Missouri, it actually did rain, and we were pretty lucky where it just kind of the clouds kind of donated for the most part around where I was at. So yeah,
it's like the universe was sending you a sign.
Oh yeah, it was perfect.
Well, we've got an exciting. Well, see, this is what I think is going to be really exciting to share with our audience on the Geek Book Club. So we started this whole thing off. Our general pilot was on Superman Red Sun. And it's a graphic novel. And, you know, comic books, you would expect we'd have some geek conversation, you know, geek book club, comic books, graphic novels. This is one of the things that I think both of us were really passionate about trying to accomplish early was not just books, not just comics. We're actually going to be tackling the play adaptation of a screenplay from just an extremely well-respected 1960s television sci-fi author, Jerome Bixby. And if any of you have ever done any amount of like community theater, black box theater, you've ever been on a play, you'll recognize the Samuel French at the bottom of a little script or a screenplay. Like, I have so many pamphlets and books in my collection with Samuel French down at the bottom, because that's the resource you use to pick up plays and other works like that that you want to perform. So I was really excited to see the stage adaptation of this, which ultimately proved to be Jerome Bixby's last work, right? This is the last thing that he wrote.
Yeah, he basically finished it, as I understand it, on his deathbed, pretty much. Yeah, because what he did before that was, he did like something for the Twilight Zone in 2002, but yeah, that was one of his very last work.
Wow. And this is something that's also, I think if I remember correctly from the Wikipedia, we've got a crackpot team of investigators for every book to give us the dossier on what's going on. That this was also something that he started writing, I believe, in the 60s, and then ultimately completed for it to be the last thing that he ever wrote. And then that was later filmed in 2007.
Yes.
That's when The Man from Earth, the film, was actually produced and distributed. And it's actually got an incredible cast. We're not going to focus too much on the film. We do need to talk about the film. Yeah. Because what we're talking about here, and this is what I think is so wonderful. If you've ever sort of torn into a play or any other type of media like that, it's always exciting to read a playwright's idea of what the subtext for a scene should be. So you're reading through, you've seen the movie, if you've seen the movie, you've seen the movie, you understand the action, you understand the character motivations, you know, there's some subtext, the actors are really good at performing ideas even when they're not speaking. And then you go through and you read the actual play transcript and you read the stage direction, and there are literally notes in there where one of the characters sort of trails off as if remembering something from long ago. It's trying to spell out emotional intent in that moment, and it's hilarious.
Yeah.
But we should actually get to the premise of of this story, and you'll all have to excuse me. I'm in the last the last dying vestiges of working off this head cold, so I'm going to try not to clear my throat too egregiously on mic here for you guys, but you will be hearing a little throughout this podcast, so I apologize up front. But let's get into The Man from Earth, because this is a wonderful classic science fiction premise realized for the screen and now easily accessible for people who would want to perform this on stage.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, this is, I mean, with such a pedigree of working on the Twilight Zone and Star Trek, this is definitely one of his more interesting works.
Oh, absolutely. And well, and we should start off actually. I mean, talking about The Man from Earth, I think it's impossible to talk about The Man from Earth without actually detailing the fact that Jerome Bixby is known for a series of later episodes in the original Star Trek. He wrote Mirror, Mirror, which is one of my favorites, mm-hmm. By Any Other Name, Day of the Dove, Requiem for Methuselah. And he also wrote the Twilight Zone episode, It's a Good Life, which was then later further adapted for the Twilight Zone movie. And so it made an appearance in that as well. And so mm-hmm. his entire career, and if you go through and you look at his short story credits especially, is that sort of journeyman, short story, episodic television background of a 1960s writer, something that I don't really feel exists in the same way today. We get little inklings of that kind of authorship on shows like what's the show, Black Mirror.
Yes,
you know, sci-fi mm-hmm. anthology. That's obviously a lot darker, but you know, Twilight Zone actually kind of stepped into that territory as well. But Jerome Bixby is really, really known for crafting intellectual, dialogue-heavy storylines that really sort of examine the human condition from a very unique perspective, and then the characters involved in that scenario all sort of have to cope with a changing scenario or with a little piece of information. And that's exactly what we find in The Man from Earth.
Oh, absolutely. And I mean, I guess we get down to it, the main premise fall is the main character by the name of John.
You have to say his last name.
Oh, well, we've got, actually...
John Oldman.
Oh, okay, yeah, there we go. John Oldman, yes.
That's kind of a big deal.
Yeah, well,
it wink, goes into it. Wink.
So he's a history professor at the university, and he just resigns. When he's been there for about 10 years, and he resigns to the shock of all of his colleagues. He invites all of them to his cabin, where he's in the process of moving out. And then all of his friends are, they're experts in different fields, which is useful for the story because he confides in them that he is in fact a Cro-Magnon who's been alive for 14,000 years.
Like you do. I mean, right? That's like Wednesday for me, right?
Oh yeah. I mean, it was easy for McLeod, you know, to tell everyone he was a Highlander.
So that's right.
But it is fantastic because it dives into the uncertainty of being able to prove it or disprove it.
Right.
You know, because how would you do that? So it's fascinating, especially for me as someone who has a passion for history.
So 14,000 years old. And what I love about this setup is that this is a story that takes place almost in real time, because uh-huh. it is literally just the conversation as to whether or not we believe John in making this assertion. You know, he's leaving under very mysterious terms. He's leaving very abruptly. He's on tenure track, and he's giving up this you know, sort of prestigious position at a smaller university. And he's then, you know, questioned quite aggressively from his colleagues. And so he gives up this idea as an intellectual exercise. You know, wouldn't it be fun our last night together if we played a game? And this game is, how would you verify if I delivered an outlandish premise that I am actually 14,000 years old? And then he's questioned, his friends all from different disciplines. He's questioned by an anthropologist. He's questioned by a biologist. He's questioned by an art historian, a student who just happens to be along for the ride, an archaeologist, and a psychiatrist all show up to sort of question, interrogate. But this play never leaves the confines of this conversation within the cabin. It's not like, you know, Highlander, where every story sort of starts off with him thousand-yard stares. He glances off into the history, the fog of history, and then we go into a flashback where it actually confirms this information. The audience is never really given enough information to decide, to confirm whether or not John is telling the truth or if John is just messing with all of his friends. And so that actually is what makes a story like this fairly charming, is the audience is given just as much information as the characters in the play. The characters are sort of in entertained and engaged in something which could be a game or could be real. And we have to just, we're along for that ride. We don't ever have something spoon-fed to us that, yes, this is true, or no, it is not. With a couple little clues along the way that may or may not confirm for people how they want to feel about the claims that John is making.
And it's nice. It's interesting, too, because since each colleague is from a different field, like for me, like I tend to go along with the anthropology and historical pokes at a story versus somebody else who, you know, who might be more engaged in, like, say, the biology side of how someone would be alive for 14,000 years and how physically you could stay alive and survive that long, still have disease and not die, live through the plague and not die.
Yeah.
And so it's nice, and it makes it more accessible, and it's really just a great example of classic science fiction that is not really, you don't really see as much anymore in mainstream media.
Excuse me. Yeah, I mean, a part of this is just, do we have the patience? And even though this film was actually produced in 2007, the structure of this is extremely anachronistic. So, I mean, we were talking about this because we both seen the film. This was actually a movie we almost covered on my old movie review show too.
Oh, nice.
This is like, I have a storied history with this book and with this, it's not even really a book, with this play and with this screenplay and with this film. We not only like, oh, we just don't really explore concepts like this anymore. I don't know that we've really explored concepts like this since the late 60s. You know, it's very patient. Some, you might even say that it's somewhat meandering. In a good way and in a bad way. And the characters exist to be their archetypes. So we don't have a lot of character development because we're coming in at the end of their relationship. And there's not a lot of room for exposition. So we just get the little like clues as to what their relationship was like over a 10-year period, just sort of tossed out there. But that's not really what's important. So this is a science fiction writer who isn't spending a lot of time. You're like, oh, you remember that time we went fishing back in 1996 where the president was this and then we did that really fun thing, Bob? That was great. I mean, like, we waste no time on these characters. And that is a very classic science fiction idea. Like, if you've ever read Asimov writes pretty terrible characters because the concept is more important. And often, like, especially if it's like his robot stories, the logic puzzle of each story is way more important than
absolutely
real characters. Well, and you get a sense of this with Bixby as well, that this is something he's really into exploring, this premise, and the life of each character is less important than the fun of the game, the fun of the chase.
Well, and you never really get a sense of how, you never really see how these characters really interact and what their friendship was like at all before, really not much time at all before before he reveals to them that he's this old, because after this point you're really basing, getting your sense of those characters or their caricatures based off of their reactions to his outlandish claims. You don't get to see them at any sort of normalcy unless you, like, you know, count the first little bit as they first get there, essentially. So that's one thing that I think that I would have liked to see a little bit more of is just how they interacted before that. So you can see, it adds a little bit more character to it, but, you know, apples and oranges.
And I mean, if wishes were horses, because this is absolutely something that I feel Bixby was not interested in doing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, like you said, we walk into this conversation, you're like, oh yeah, you know, and you know, John, we're really gonna miss you. So John, why are you leaving? Well, wouldn't you know it, I'm a 14,000-year-old caveman. Okay. I mean, it's almost that fast that we get into it. But I mean, there's something really romantic, and I think this is a topic that only a science fiction author. I don't want to say it that way. How do I want to say this? I want to say that a classic science fiction author can examine with this kind of efficiency, but also with a little hint of romance. Mm-hmm. Because there are these tests that the other characters then start sending John's way. Like, well, how would you know where you were 14,000 years ago? Or what is your earliest memory? Or what did you used to do for food? Or how did you survive when you started outliving your other cavemen? And the answers that John gives are very practical. But they're also, I mean, there is that just sense of romance to some of the notions as well, like bringing up a corollary, like, can you remember where you were April 17th, you know, 30 years ago? Okay, well, now try and extrapolate that to April 17th before we had calendars and 10,000 years ago.
Right. Or somebody asking, well, do you have any relics? And he's like, well, you know, see this pen, you know, why would I hold on to this for 4,000, you know, 4,000 years from now? We'll have, you know, we won't even be using things like this. It's a waste, you know? So it's really fascinating. All of the different tests that they bring to him, because they still don't definitively disprove him either, just to the nature of it. But,
it is sort of a lively discussion about faith. You know, he's delivered a premise which can be neither proven nor disproven in the context of a single conversation. And he's trying to deliver evidence. You're like, oh, well, if you really wanted to prove this, why don't you submit to some blood tests and we can study that? And he's like, well, you know, I'd rather not be poked and prodded and be a lab rat. Yeah. And it would be bad if, you know, other people were to find out my secret.
Mm-hmm. We could get some smoking man action going on.
Yeah, some X-Files. Yeah. But that also brings up the interesting idea. Like, the reason why he's leaving is because every 10 years or so, people start to realize, like, oh, hey, by the way, John doesn't age ever, like, at all.
Mm-hmm.
So what's up with that?
Well, and it's a lot harder in the pre-modern era, where people, you know, they talk about you know, whether he's not sure whether he's stealing life force of others, or
that's right,
like the prehistoric origin of the vampire myth. Oh man,
which I have to take some umbrage with, because I am obnoxiously well read on, you know, the Proto-Slavic origins for a lot of our mythological beasties, and it's not exactly how vampires came to be. They have a very modern interpretation of the vampire as applied to John, and that's yes, that's easy to sort of work backwards from, but that's not really what the vampire myth was warning us about, was the guy who didn't age. It was, you know, the corruption of outside influences and people who were not from your tribe, which I guess kind of plays into what John's talking about, but not in the way they describe it in The Man from Earth.
Right.
It's a little overly simplistic. Come on. Yeah.
Well, it's how, you know, how much can they do in you know, the space of a play, I guess. How deep can they get into it and still keep an audience engaged as well?
Right. Well, and because of that, we have to give them a few passes on this premise, again, because the chase is more interesting than the facts.
Oh, absolutely.
And because I just feel like, so, you know, again, as a quick tangent, because we talked about this a little off camera too, and it's definitely something I want to explore. When we're looking at, you know, a 14,000-year-old life form, if we're taking John's premise as true, I feel this entity would essentially be a sociopath by this point. What relationship can you have with humanity when the people you interact with are gone in the blink of an eye, essentially? Because, I mean, just think about it. As you get older, like, a day becomes a very short period of time. When you were a little kid, a day was crazy long. And, like, your perception of time changes as you get older. Add to that, you know, 13,900 more years than the oldest living person can be around. And I mean, like, I don't know that you could even have the relationship one would have with, like, a house cat or, like, a dog. right? Like, you, how could you regard a human, a regular, you know, sort of regularly lived between 70 and 90 year old human, with anything resembling, you know, equality, you know, of experience, of perception, of knowledge, of education, and just how fast would a day fly by? Like, every relationship you'd have would be like trying to have a relationship with an insect that only lived for a week.
Well, do you think that that it's possible for someone who's that long lived, their perception, because I can definitely see that perception being especially poignant in the pre-modern era, the pre-information era. And do you think that that perception could potentially change as people are exposed to more ideas and have more information at their fingertips, you know, kind of in the exponential growth that we have as a society?
It's interesting. It's interesting that you also frame this in the context of sort of the pre and post information age, because this story was started in the 60s and was completed in 2007, you know, so just on the cusp of the social media craze of the internet era, as we understand it today, the sharing economy and how you could look up anything about anyone at any time. And so John dodges a huge bullet just by virtue of this story being 3 years too early
Facebook was just starting, you know. It was the exclusivity era,
right?
It goes into, you know, we can get into this a little later too about like just being able, just blending in after that in the information era, you're like restarting, because, you know, going back and every decade switching out your, you know, to a different life, essentially restarting your life, is a lot harder in the information age. So, or, you know, you get the little picture on Google Photos or Facebook that, you know, somebody matches up and then an algorithm catches them.
Yeah, facial recognition is about to screw John up.
Yes.
So we've got in the live chat, we've got from Jay Lowe, which I love that screen name on YouTube. I would have explored all of Japan as a nameless ronin collecting samurai swords for my pure enjoyment. And like, and that would have been great during that sort of ronin era of Japan, but then what after? What would you do? Yeah. I mean, again, that's what's so interesting about this concept, because I still feel like the discussion is framed by the longevity of the normal human then applied to John, who can tell a story about being 14,000 years old, right? Because I feel like most people sort of examine immortality within a window of their normal life expectancy, you know, like,
yeah, absolutely. I would,
you know, like a future where we can travel the stars and we could, you know, teleport and have, you know, telepathy either through mechanical means or through evolution. And how amazing would that be? And I still feel like I'm still kind of limited to within the perception of my own mortality, like about 100 years, give or take.
Well, I mean,
and then what would I do after that? And then I have to imagine like another like 100-year window, you know, trying to imagine 1400 times more. Oh, wait, no, 140 times more than that is really difficult for my brain to try and encompass.
Well, I mean, gosh, yeah, I mean, John's character is dipping into, well, he talks about how he was migrating and he saw with his tribe and he saw this big valley. He says all the information that he has from his experiences that he equates to modern knowledge, you know, is through humanity discovering it. Well, what he thinks he saw was where the English Channel was, but at the time it was just a little bit low valley. His lifespan is tipping into the geological scale of time, which, I mean, I can't even wrap my head around that. Going through how many different eras and how many different cultures, how does your personality change over time? You could be a different person like just personality, not just pretending, but just like your core personality could change multiple times.
Right. Well, and I think that is something that John alludes to in the book, is that like, you know, not only could your personality change, it's like it's sort of necessary mm-hmm. that your personality changes over time. I mean, we've got another mention here in the live chat from Chris Orlando. A year would feel like a day for John in respect to his entire life. And the notion that, you know, like I'm the same person who I was a week ago is difficult to justify, like, you know, that I'll be the same person that I will be on my deathbed, let alone, you know, if I had this wealth of experience behind me. Now, on Twitter, one of the other comments that I got that I thought was pretty excellent, because this sort of fits into another part of the discussion of the play. This comes from Carolyn Wallace. I would be looking for other people like me. If John really is this ageless, timeless, immortal caveman, it stands to reason that he might not be the only one. And there is mention of that in this story. Mm-hmm. But again, we're talking about an ultra efficient story delivered just through conversation. So we never get the flashback. We never get, you know, like I said, it's not like Highlander. It's not like they're just
going to
go
right. We don't have Sean Connery.
No. You know, the Spaniard. nothing like that. But John does bring that up, because someone in questioning John, you know, did you ever encounter someone else like you? And he says that he thinks he might have, but again, he encounters someone who claims to be like him in being extremely long lived, but they were never able to verify that against each other.
Mm-hmm.
So even for John is now claiming, you know, like, how would you prove that someone else is also immortal? Just as we're having this conversation now, you can't prove or disprove that I am what I say I am. And again, the whole play, the whole film hinges on this. You can't prove me right. You can't prove me wrong, but we have to examine this exercise and we have to decide whether or not John is messing with his friends.
Oh yeah. And it's fascinating how they draw it out. And I mean, there are twists and turns along the way as well, as far as between some of the different characters or caricatures. But they never really, through most of it, break through to that definite. There's no sense of definite in there, except for some of the knowledge, which even then, the knowledge that's brought by some of his friends and experts are subject to question based off of this premise. So,
well, and I do have to, I mean, like, if I'm going to give this like sort of a dubious award of, you know, honor, of lameness and honor, I feel that the way Jerome Bixby writes the psychiatrist as being extremely aggressive and then is given just a hint of a backstory to explain his aggression.
Emotionally compromised a little bit.
Well, and let's talk about this too, because like I think a lot of people will probably be more apt to experience the story through the film than through this play. Mm-hmm. Again, this adaptation of the play, and that's not right or wrong. I mean, we're talking about this because this was actually a really interesting thought project to read the play adaptation of a screenplay, but the play adaptation of a screenplay which plays like a play.
Yes.
in the casting, the person who they've chosen as the psychiatrist I've already forgotten his name, and I had the list up right in front of me.
It's a jump to conclusions Matt. Guy
from Office Space. Richard Real? Richard Ryle?
Oh yeah.
I'm entirely sure what his name is. I feel bad for a number of actors in the film, because this cast is excellent. These are all veteran TV and film actors, but I feel most of them have been somewhat miscast. And so you have Richard Real, who's known for being sort of apoplectic, a very playful, funny, angry energy that he brings to a number of his characters, trying to play this emotionally distraught psychiatrist attacking John. And all I can see is jump to conclusions, Matt guy.
Yes.
And that's terrible because it's not his fault. I feel like he was just somewhat miscast in this adventure.
Yeah, well, and I mean, and as we discussed before too, another one of the characters is Kern Worf's brother from Star Trek.
Tony Todd.
Yes.
And again, Tony Todd always brings such an air of... I mean, like, he's such a powerful character, and you've seen him in so many roles. I mean, like, Kern is a good example. I mean, there's a ferocity to a Tony Todd performance, which, again, is that what we were looking for in the casting of a talking exploration of sort of meta conversation? And that's not Tony Todd's fault.
No, it's not his fault.
I don't think, you know who we need for someone kind of chill and in the middle of a conversation about something kind of wacky? That really ferocious Klingon dude. That's like the guy who played in the modern day remake of Night of the Living Dead, like bashing zombie heads.
We really need Candyman for this role.
Yeah, that's so terrible because like Tony Todd is a badass.
Oh yeah, I know, he's great,
but he's a badass. That's like also part of the problem.
Oh man, yeah. I will say Ellen Crawford, who played Edith, I think she did a pretty good
absolutely
job.
Perfect. I mean, actually, I think the women in general are actually more on point for the casting than the men. Harry, who is the I've got the biology. Professor. John Billingsley, also from a variant of Star Trek. I think he's a little hit or miss, but he's still kind of in the vein of the character that he's portraying in Star Trek, and so he's more appropriate, I feel, for the biology professor that's questioning John about like his health and his life. I think the guy who was best cast was Art, played by William Catt, also known as the greatest American hero, who I think he's supposed to be the smart alecky guy. And he's always sort of played the smart alecky guy. Mm-hmm. And as the archaeology professor who sort of understands the window of time that John is trying to describe is kind of the most shrug-worthy about John's claim.
The story.
And that was the right actor. I think that was the right actor to give that kind of a role to.
Yeah, he handled it pretty well, especially based off of just how he's written in the play, as it were. I will say the way that they handled it in the film with him, because he brought along like a student. And when I first saw, because I saw the film first and then I read this, I liked the way it was written a little more. Maybe it's just how I interpreted it, but it's felt a little borderline inappropriate maybe with the teacher and the student. But luckily they didn't really. The reason why they had them though was so that they could have a student's point of view in asking a lot of these questions that you get. So I give it a pass.
The student is the voice of the audience.
Yes.
You know, and again, it's sort of classic sci-fi. Like you could see someone who used to write on Star Trek going, well, there are probably a bunch of, you know, ignorant, scientifically illiterate people. I said unliterate.
That was awesome.
Oh man, this cold is amazing. There are probably a number of scientifically illiterate people in the audience. So we need someone who can ask those sort of, because it's not even expository questions. It's just like, oh, what does that mean? Oh, well, the Paleolithic era was where we had spears and we would hunt mastodon. You know, like you just needed that one character. But you're right. I don't think Jerome Bixby had any intent for the relationship between the student and Art to be anything more than just a student coming to visit a professor who was leaving. And the film does give it just a little bit of the air that there is something happening between those two characters. Thankfully, there's literally no time for them to explore whether or not that was an inappropriate relationship. It's sort of winked at throughout the film.
And it's so open. The whole format of this story is so open that you can really read into a lot of and put your own sort of imagination and add to these characters / caricatures.
Oh, absolutely.
And that's part of the
caricatures is also a good word too, because we're talking about an intellectual exercise. And like I said before, there's that fine line. It really will come down. When you're actually reading the play, every single scene comes down to, if I have an amazing actor in this role, I've got a beautiful archetype. If I've got a hammy or a hacky actor in this role, it is just a gross caricature of what a professor should be. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you were looking at doing this on stage at your local community theater, you would really have to nail the casting for every single role. And the one role you could probably get away with being a little hammier or being just, you know, the worst actor in the play would probably be John.
Oh, yeah.
He's the one who's just sending up the softballs for mm-hmm. all of the other professors to react to. He's the one that's trying to tilt their worldview a couple degrees. So it's actually less important that you nail John's performance. It's every single other character has to be on point with how they're responding to John, how they're being hurt by John. Some of these characters are very affected because mm-hmm. they thought he was their friend, and now he's doing this thing which could be upsetting, or he's doing this thing which could show that he's mentally unstable. And that also affects them tremendously throughout this very brief examination. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is almost something that could have played in an hour-long science fiction anthology. Like, it really does feel like it could have been lifted from something like Twilight Zone or Night Gallery.
I'm really surprised
it had been an hour long.
I'm really surprised that this was never written as an episode of the Twilight Zone. Like, it's perfect for it. Absolutely perfect for it. Or gosh, could you imagine an X-Files episode like that?
Oh, totally.
Well, and I mean, man.
X-Files played with, what was the stretchy guy in the X-Files who would eat people's livers? It was like,
he was the guy who was going like through pipes and everything?
Yeah, it was season one. It's still one of my all-time favorite. Because he also comes back later on.
Oh, does?
Yeah, there are two. I think there were two episodes with Stretchy Guy. But again, that was the examination of like, well, we've got this evidence of someone who committed murders similar to this like 30 years or 50 years ago. And he has the same fingerprints. That's really weird.
Yeah.
Oh, man. And so this would have been right up that kind of creature of the week sort of alley. But I think Twilight Zone. So for all of Bixby's efficiency, maybe one of the criticisms I would have is he might have too many characters questioning. I really feel like because one of the characters is very religious and the rest of them are much more scientific in their approach to talking to John. And I kind of feel like you could maybe whittle this story down if we were looking at trying to do it for an episode of The Twilight Zone or for an hour-long sci-fi anthology episode. I think you could whittle this down to John, a science-y professor, and a more religious individual who was a friend of John's. And I think you could have almost exactly the same kind of examination of the premise, streamline it, and then maybe better inform the relationships between a trio of talking characters as opposed to a quintet of professors questioning John.
Yeah, well, if you took it to, like, say, I had it as an episode of The Twilight Zone, I'm wondering whether or not they'd have John as the main character that the narrative follows, or if it's someone else, like a student, or one of the, I'd say the student probably would be the most likely one that they'd have in there as the main character of the narrative who follows this and then has you're gauging their reactions in that smaller group on them. So it's kind of the relatable character, I would think. But yeah.
I think this premise is one that I think we've explored similar ideas, but I don't know that anything else that I've read or anything else that I've seen has taken such a casual approach to this premise. I think we keep joking about it, but I think, you know, like one of the closest corollaries would be a show like Highlander, you know, or the movies, the Highlander films. Because we explore time through this one character's perspective, but the fun of that is the adventure of living through that time. Mm-hmm. Here, we're sort of looking at the downside. You know, there are significant downsides to John's condition if he really is this immortal individual. And when we examine it from his perspective, it's all about the compromises of having this this longevity.
Oh yeah. Well, and it's, I mean, I'm sure he doesn't really think of it necessarily as a gift. I mean, everyone that you know, everyone that you could know and love will be gone in a blink,
in the blink of an eye.
Yeah. In the blink of an eye. Yeah. And yeah, it's, I mean, it's in a lot of ways, it can be a curse. And, you know, he describes, you know, cause he has an almost data like view on humanity, data from Star Trek, I'll clarify, like where he is kind of the outside view of it. And he talks about how humanity just keeps making the same mistakes over and over again, no matter what he does, no matter how, and keep in mind also, he's not any sort of all knowing Superman. You know, he could have learned phrenology at one point, but well, that turned out to be a bust.
Right. Imagine if he had dedicated his life to like alchemy.
Why won't this turn into gold? I've tried for 3,000 years.
This is the worst. Yeah. Go be an attorney.
Yeah. Pretty. Oh God. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it's really fascinating. It would be even, I think it would be fascinating in a long form, as well. Like, TV series even, or book series might be actually pretty interesting too. But for
a book series, like, wouldn't we have to confirm immediately that what he says is true? And then don't we kind of just end up with Highlander?
Yeah, well, I guess it would have to be made, well, no, because it'd be retelling the same story. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
No, I mean, like, this is what's dangerous, is like what Jerome Bixby's written here is so fragile. Because it exists in its own window, its own bubble of conversation.
Yeah.
Because there are some things. Actually, you know what? Let's get into spoilers. So we're not okay. going to ruin the end of this story. We want you to read it, and we want you to go and watch the movie. Not necessarily because, like I said, I'm not recommending this film because I think it's such a great film. But I think it's a great premise explored by some creative and passionate low budget filmmakers. I think the movie was shot. You were saying the movie was shot for something like $200,000.
Yep. It was shot for $200,000. And I don't have any figures on how much it made.
And,
but yeah.
And oh no, I can't even believe it. It made its money back at the box office. But also, I mean, we're talking about a 90-minute commitment if you're reading it or if you're watching it.
Pretty much. So
this is a little hors d'oeuvre of a story. We're probably going to talk about it for almost as long as it would take you to read yes. in real time. sorry, that's kind of ridiculous. So we don't want to spoil the ultimate ending, but we do have a couple like ignoble honors that we need to deliver. And one of them is the premise that John delivers. As the game evolves and as the questioning gets more intense, people start asking about things like religion and whether or not he followed a particular religion, or was he someone in history who was maybe a part of a religion? And it comes to light that John is claiming that there was a time, roughly 2,000 years ago, where he was trying to spread some ideas that he'd learned from the Buddha, like you do, and that those ideas were sort of, you know, massaged and would later form the core tenets of this little sect of religious individuals known as Christianity.
Just a little. And,
yeah, just a little bit. Just kind of gave it a nudge. And wouldn't you know it, John is Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Or I should say more, John claims to be the indirect inspiration for the mythological figure who would be known as Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, there are certain things I like about like how a myth can be, how a myth can just grow from something. But with this story, I felt like it was reaching a little too far it went to an extreme. I'll put it that way.
Well, doesn't it feel like, you know, when someone's had like a past life experience, they're never like some chambermaid. They're always like, I was Napoleon in a past life.
Yeah, exactly. He should have been Brian from Life of Brian. <You
know>? I was almost about to break out into the song if my throat hadn't decided to back up.
But yeah, I mean, it's, yeah, it, well, one thing I will say that's good about it is it does help to drive especially certain characters, to the edge of what they can tolerate, and a lot of it tends to just drive the story forward and to set all of the characters to a new level of stress, and it does that very effectively.
Yeah.
I just feel like they were reaching a little bit with it.
Well, and doesn't that also feel like a classic 1960s trope, though? Tell me Star Trek, especially Star Trek, wasn't all about tearing down false idols, tearing down those who claimed to be gods. And then also pointing out our foibles in fighting with those of us who had different idols or different gods. I mean, this is sort of like right in the heart of 1960s television.
Oh yeah, I mean, you see this in Requiem for Methuselah, the episode that he wrote for the original series, where just for people who haven't seen it, essentially the Enterprise crew comes across a person on a planet who named Flint, who happened to be Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci, and all the famous Renaissance people, because he could be more than one person at the same time, but he's not perfect by any means. And I mean, gosh, it's a similar thing with, now this is written by someone else, but who mourns for Adonis? Well, it's literally a god.
So, I mean, this is classic Star Trek territory.
I know. And it's, I feel like with who more, I mean, Requiem for Methuselah had a lot of, I feel like he was working around a lot of these ideas in his head with that. And a lot of, Bixby son would be able to tell us, but it feels like he used some of the thoughts that he had from working on that and brought it into this story, it worked out pretty well.
Well, it works out well, but again, I feel like the most accessible version of this still, there are faults in its delivery.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things, like, for as much as I really do enjoy, I mean, so, you know, I wasn't really predisposed to being a fan of Jerome Bixby until, like, I kind of saw, like, he's written a lot of TV, because he also wrote Westerns. He wrote a ton of short stories. And it turns out, like, I've just floated around his career by being a fan of 1960s film and TV. Without even really knowing that, I like, oh yeah, I really liked that episode. Oh, that was another Jerome Bixby episode. Mirror. Freaking awesome episode of Star Trek.
Well, probably one of the best episodes of Star Trek.
I mean, phenomenal, right? So, So when we get to this piece of media, though, we are dealing with culture shock in a really interesting way. The notion of, like, my absolute favorite paranoia-driven or classic sci-fi-driven 60s content filtered through a more modern lens with modern television and film actors. And those are difficult worlds to reconcile. And I think it's most apparent where, for both the film and for the play version, the adaptation that you would put on stage, we can't complete this story in real time. That's what I think is one of the most frustrating aspects of recommending this piece of media, literature or film, is the staging of this is so on point for this conversation to evolve over 90 minutes, but there's still no good way to conclude the story without, like, some kind of passage of time.
Right. Well, and
we get to the end, and in the play, it's literally like the last three lines of dialogue happen like hours after everything else, with the only passage of time scene change that happens in the entire show. I mean, you would get to the end of the play, lights would go down, the lights would come back up, it's nighttime now. And they only have like three lines of dialogue left. It's like the biggest no-no staging a play.
And it's so much easier to have that transition in film versus a play.
Oh, totally.
Absolutely. And I feel
they handle it better in the film, but there is a very jarring sense of, we need to end this. And there's a big bright over button that gets pushed at the end of the film. It is... I feel it would be disastrous to accomplish it the way that they've written it for the stage show, where it's lights down, lights up, now it's nighttime, and then the play's over. There's no act, there's no intermission, right? This is basically a one act.
They just need to have John come out at the end and just be like, oh crap, I got 5 minutes left. Well, bye, you know.
it's like when you're like a theater student in high school and you get to the end of your dramatic monologue, and before you let the moment resonate, you turn to the crowd and say, and scene. You know?
Yeah, like, yes.
It would be like John delivers his last line of dialogue and play over. And everyone comes out for their curtain call and everyone bows, and everyone can applaud our tremendous performance. If any of you ever in the position to stage this play, ignore the stage direction on the passage of time for the end of this show and try and find something that emulates the film just a little bit more in smoothly transitioning to the end of the story. Because this like almost act break style of completion for the story is, it was jarring to read it. It was terrible to read it.
And it wouldn't take that much to really rework it, really. It wouldn't take a bunch of work, you know, to really work
being the Shakespeare nut that I am, coming from a background in theater, loving to do experimental black box. You know, black box theater is all about, like, we have no budget. There's literally a stage which has like seating for 30, and it's in a room that's just painted black. Can we create something that the audience is going to enjoy? I am a number one, the first guy to say, ignore the stage direction. Don't do what the stage direction said, because it's not going to work. It's not going to work in that kind of limited resources. And even if you were to put this on a big grand stage or a community theater stage, a really good proscenium, the whole play is utterly contained in one living room. Mm-hmm. You know, there is no action outside. There is no scene. Like, you wanted a scene of them like teaching or something like that, you know, like, There is no other location. There is no other place. It's the cabin. You have people that come into and out of the cabin, so you need to be able to show the outside of the cabin. But then the core of this conversation happens in a living room, and that's it.
Yeah, I would have liked. That's why I would have liked to have seen just a scene at the university where he's like wrapping up a lecture, and it's his last lecture or something, and like, you know, the very end tidbits, and he sees a couple of his friends. He's like, "Hey, why don't you come on over to my place?" And then done. And then that way you've got a beginning where they have that and an end. So there's symmetry at least.
You know, and it's funny that you bring that up, because because there is outside information from the film and from the play, where the man who plays John Oldman, he was a producer on the original. Was he the director?
Let's see.
David Lee Smith. No, he was just a star. Okay. He wasn't the director. Richard Shankman was the director. Mm-hmm. But there is apparently a sequel, which was supposed to come out this year, which no one has seen. Of this is a terrible name.
yeah, it's awful.
Even have to pull it. The Man from Earth, Holocene, Holocene. Now, you know, you might be asking yourself, what the hell is a Holocene? Well, a Holocene is the geological epoch that began after the Pleistocene at approximately 11,700 years before AD 2000 and continues to the present. The term recent, usually capitalized, has often been used as an exact synonym of Holocene. So when we talk about recent history, we're talking within a window of around 14,000 years, and that's known as the Holocene. This is the worst thing you could name your movie as a sequel to The Man from Earth, following the same actor who has obviously aged this time in 2007.
Oh, man.
And they had to make it a part of the story where John now realizes that he is actually aging. So whether or not now we would ever have believed John's story, now we've got another piece of media which will be coming out. And you know, I don't know what that does to the charm of the original. It's obviously not written by Jerome Bixby. It sounds like it's got a little bit more of an adventure theme to it that other people are catching on to John's longevity, and he has to escape the forces of people in suits investigating him.
It makes me, well, one, it's produced and written by Emerson Bixby. It feels a lot to me like it could, like they're wanting to handle it almost like Dexter in a way.
A little bit.
You know, which...
Only if Dexter were only 2 90-minute movies.
Yes. Yeah, pretty much. Well, and, you know, it's... And they've talked about how, like, if it's successful, they could want it to be a TV series, which I think it would work better as a TV series if they... Well, if they kept it simple.
I think, see, this is where I get so, you know, when someone delivers a premise and you really want to explore that world, the whole premise that Jerome Bixby set up was he wanted you to ask questions and he wanted you to think. He wanted you to critically analyze a claim, right? This is one of the most classically agnostic things I've ever written. Not agnostic, like I'm wishy-washy, I'm halfway in between being religious and non-religious. I mean, like, the old school definition of agnosticism, like T.H. Huxley, Darwin's bulldog, you know, the notion that you will examine a claim for its veracity, for its truth, and you will also question what you consider to be true. Like, you will always try to verify the information you hold as truth. That's what original agnosticism was. It was sort of a philosophical standpoint to people who claimed to know what happened after you died. It wasn't necessarily how religious you were on a spectrum of super godliness to super atheist. That's not what this was. And I feel like the charm of that thought experiment evaporates as soon as you try to expand the world, because once you give evidence, you can analyze the evidence and you can determine more about how you feel about a particular claim. Here, it's a claim given with no evidence. Would you build a religion around this guy? Would you believe this guy? Would you try and capture him and study him in a lab just because he said something? And that, to me, becomes what's powerful about this statement. Is it forces you and the audience to try and consider, like, how would you respond to this? How would you react to it? And then it leaves you sort of in the lurch for the strongest conclusions of the claim being mentioned, the claim being discussed. And that's what's interesting to me. But I can also see where it's probably very unfulfilling for a lot of people out there to be watching something like that.
Yeah. Well, and I feel, and well, and I get the view that it's, the impression that is that it's more of like a project of love. And it's like, I don't want to dissuade them from that, but at the same time, you can do just as thought provoking of stories without having to stay with the same universe and change the original premise.
So the hope I have, and again, it's because we can't watch it. I don't think it's been released anywhere, but The Man from Earth Holocene is written by Emerson Bixby, Jerome Bixby's son. So I'm hoping that it's with the spirit of trying to continue the thought experiment and less about trying to turn, because, you know, I don't read this play. I don't read The Man from Earth and think, you know what this really needed? A car chase.
Yeah, no. Oh God, no. Oh man. Well, and it, you know, it'd just be on some desert. I felt more like they were more likely to have a crossover with Breaking Bad with the location that they were at than anything X-Files or anything.
Why you gotta bring up my home turf? You know, like, it's, you know, well, Albuquerque's a beautiful place with excellent food. That's all I'm saying.
Oh man. Well, you know, it's an interesting story. Yeah. But it has problems with the translation into long form or just any sort of sequel. And it's, I'll still watch it.
No, I mean, as soon as I can get my hands on it, I'm going to be checking it out because I want to see what they accomplish, especially for having the same lead, David Lee Smith, and for having the same director, Richard Shankman.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. So I feel like there's the right continuity. And I feel that it's appropriate to look at a film in 2017 coming 10 years after the original, fitting in with the storyline of John Oldman needing to pull up his roots every decade.
Oh, like, yeah. So he's moving on from where he moved on to.
Totally. Right.
Yeah.
So there is something like not necessarily in the same sort of like a dedication to craft is what was that movie that that Ethan Hawke did that was like shot over like 20 years or something, like Boyhood. Was that what it was?
Oh yeah. Boyhood.
So we obviously don't have the same commitment to producing a piece of media like that, but there is something really charming about the notion of these people being able to revisit this. Same thing with like, what was it after? Oh God, I can't remember these like really indie film names. It's like Before Sunrise and Before Sunset, revisiting these characters after windows of time, knowing that the actors had actually aged that much along the way. Mm-hmm. I feel the only way you could do this story right is to explore that. But then you also have to add in the conceit that your immortal dude ages.
Time. One thing I did notice is William Catt's art is in this new story too. And so, and with the plot, and as we were talking about this earlier, but part of the plot is that he's aging now, that John is aging. Well, and seeing how art kind of ended up having a little bit more of an antagonistic view of the whole thing. And so now seeing, I'm wondering if he would be I guess a quote unquote antagonist, maybe, I don't know. But he, as someone else who's aging, he'll actually
recognize
him and recognize that he's older. And I don't know. It's going to be interesting. I'm just happy that Michael Dorn's in this now. Another Klingon. We got both the sons of Moog in this universe.
I you know what? I mean, do you think that maybe they reached out to Tony Todd again? He was like, nah, I've been there, done that.
Probably.
Go get Dorn. Go get that guy.
Yeah. He's like,
he'll be happy to do something that doesn't involve some kind of forehead prosthetic.
Yeah, he's like, you know, yeah, he's happy he's just not having to go into another convention, you know? No, I'm just joking, you know?
I have to believe that they wouldn't do it if they didn't enjoy.
That's absolutely true. Oh, no, yeah, like, absolutely.
I also know just from having been to a few myself, like, man, that's a pretty weighty investment in hand sanitizer, just saying.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. I went to one time, and I brought my own hand sanitizer. I was like, yeah, might as well, you know? And they were like, thanks.
When I go to trade shows, I usually keep one clipped to my bag, and it's like every meeting, hand sanitizer for all, disinfected. It's actually probably terrible for you. We're finding out that like there's like the flora and fauna of like your skin gets savage. But it's like, if I don't do that, then I'm going to end up with the plague every time I travel overseas.
Oh, man, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'll never ever forget the plagues of Trek conventions gone by.
So I feel we have sidetracked the discussion.
Yeah, sorry. Man, pretty
severely. And then, like I said, we've talked about this almost as long as the film takes to watch. So we should probably wrap this up. But one, this was actually just a really fun homecoming for me. Like I said, having been a theater student, having studied theater, and especially being a script analysis nerd, like I really liked dissecting pieces of literature, especially stage performance, the writing that goes into a stage performance from the author's perspective, and trying to glean what it was that the author was trying to accomplish. Everything that they write, that an author writes, is obviously designed to entertain. But I feel like in The Man from Earth, and one of the things that might not be accessible from watching the film is unraveling what Bixby is also trying to accomplish while entertaining. And it is a very 1960s perspective on telling a story about faith. I think that the notion of faith gets steamrollered in the movie by the faithy character.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't focus on the claims being made by John being sort of an allegory for, not an allegory, that's not the right word, but I think you guys will know what I mean. It just the examination of a claim without substance being examined. And it's a very classic science fiction way to go about unraveling how you feel about something. You know, like Arthur C. Clarke, I think, was a master of doing this too. A lot of his stories are about like human ascendance, or what if our evolution were influenced by outside aliens? Like Arthur C. Clarke wrote some of the best, you know, intelligent design stories that were ever written. But as like a diehard scientist, that's okay to tell, to ask your readers or to ask your viewers to go on that kind of an examination, to go on that kind of a fictional story, even if you don't necessarily feel that it's scientifically accurate or you don't believe that that's how things really went down. It's okay to ask some big questions that way. It's like your little spoonful of sugar before you really try and rock someone's worldview.
Oh, absolutely. Well, and one thing I like about this story too, is it makes you think, well, what if, you know, what if my best friend said the same thing, and would I have enough trust and faith in them to believe them at face value, or would I just think they're insane? Or, you know, and it's a nice, it's a very interesting examination and a self-examination. It's an introspective examination on your level of trust and how much you can, how much faith you're willing to give in. And you hit the nail right on the head with all of it. It was, yeah, fantastic.
Well, I mean, it's totally like that time, Andrew, where you told me that you were a telekinetic on Thursdays, but only you could only move things with your mind that were the color chartreuse. And I called BS, but I still have faith in our friendship.
No, you know,
that's how it works. That's very much like the man from Earth.
Yeah, and I know it was my bad. It was Wednesdays.
The Wednesday telekinesis. Yeah. That's why you couldn't do it when you told me, because it was a Thursday. I get
it's the power of hump day, you know.
True story. All right, you know what? On that note, we do have to put a pin in this, because now we're starting to get a little punch drunk, and I have had way too much kombucha to make it through this. So we don't have the date nailed down just yet, but in roughly 1 month, we're going to be talking about our next book on the Geek Book Club. And this one, so for Man from Earth, like I said, you probably could have read this in 90 minutes if you picked up the play from Samuel French like we did.
Oh, yeah.
And which you still can. I mean, it's like you just flipped through it. You're like, I'm actually really happy we're doing the next episode in about a month, because this is a recommendation that has come from, this is an author that my sister and my brother-in-law really hipped me to, and it's a gentleman by the name of Ken Liu. Well, this one to unpack. So the book that we're going to read next month is The Three-Body Problem. I'm going to butcher the actual author's name. Cixin Liu is the actual author, but Ken Liu has developed this incredible reputation for translating Chinese literature for Western audiences. And so along the way, I would also highly recommend picking up Ken Liu's The Paper Menagerie. It's a collection of short stories that he's written, and it's this incredible emotional and thoughtful flavor of science fiction with a very Asian perspective. He writes stories from a Japanese perspective. He writes stories from a Chinese perspective. But The Three-Body Problem is a book, is from a Chinese author, translated by Ken Liu. And so this is a lot. This is going to take you a lot more time to get through than The Man from Earth did. I'm only about 20, 30 pages into it so far, and I'm already just in love with the setup for this story. So this is what we're going to cover next month. We'll have links where you can pick up a copy of The Three-Body Problem, or we'd also highly recommend supporting your local library with not only getting your library card and taking books from them, but then also, you know, like whatever you can do to help support the local, you know, book repository, I almost said suppository. That was
That's a different establishment. You
that's
know?
A completely different thing.
Yeah,
you probably don't want to get into on the YouTube would shut my channel down. That would be that.
Absolutely. One also, you can not only get the book itself from your local library, but you can even get the audiobook. They have an audio translation of it as well.
So you said that you had started it through the audiobook, right?
Yes. I've not gotten very far at all in it, but yes, I have. I'm starting out with the audiobook.
So I want to play this game with you. If you're game, What I would like to do is read the actual dead tree pulp version of this book. Have you go through the audiobook and see what our experiences are like, where I'm reading the one translation from Chinese to English, and you're going through someone reading the story of the English translation. If you're game, if you finish it on the audiobook. Okay.
Oh yeah.
There's something to me that's really wonderful about audiobooks, but to me it's still yet like it's a flavor of an adaptation, right? Mm-hmm. You're sort of getting to piggyback a little bit on an outside imagination to help tell that story. So that's kind of what I'd like to see, what your experience is with the audiobook, and see how that compares to my own brute force imagination trying to read through this thing.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've always liked audiobooks too. So because I'll drive around, or if I'm cleaning or something, listen to the audiobook. It's a lot better than having the TV on. So, yeah. Well,
I'm in that really bad habit of, like, I read before I go to bed, which means I read 10 pages and I fall asleep.
I've done that so many times recently.
Oh, so bad. I mean, I've got a flight tomorrow, so hopefully I'll be able to make it through a couple hours of reading on the plane. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
On that note, let's go ahead and wrap this up. Everybody, thank you so much for participating in the Geek Book Club, especially those of you in the live chat, folks who are asking questions on Twitter, joining the conversation. As we go through these, we're going to try and give you enough heads up time so that you can read along with us, and you can participate more in the conversation. You can drop us more messages and just share your own thoughts with what you think about our analysis. If you think we're on point, if you think we're totally full of crap, probably more the latter, definitely drop us a line. Give us all a follows on the internets. Obviously, this YouTube channel is where we're going to be hosting the live stream. We're also going to be producing a high quality audio version, which there's going to be an RSS feed on my blog, somegadgetguy.com. And give us each a follow on the Twitters, where you can find my co-host Andrew, who somehow has lost his lower third.
Oh, what?
Just disappeared because Google hates us. Google just can't get everything to work on any live broadcast. This is terrible.
Next time I'll just get a sign ready.
Yeah, we're gonna have to just hold up written signs at this point. You can find my buddy Andrew as @fatproduce, just spelled like it sounds. And I of course am @somegadgetguy. And you can also shoot me an email if you have book recommendations too, if you don't want to use the social media, juan@somegadgetguy.com. Like I said, thanks so much for watching. Subscribe to the channel. Follow us on the internet, on the Twitters. I don't know if you do the Instagrams, you can do that too, but we won't be talking about books on the on the Instagrams because that's not really appropriate for it.
I'll take a photo of the book and then we can talk about it.
You do that.
Yeah.
Perfect. It's just like reading. And on that note, I bid you all a good, happy reading time. I have no good slogan to end the podcast. I need like a good, pithy, catchy, and have fun reading some books or something like that.
Literacy.
Literacy. There you go.
Yeah.
Literacy. And I'm pushing. Stop broadcast.